Welcome to Brighton.
We are members of the British Sugarcraft Guild. We had an exhibition here in Brighton and decided we'd make something that looked like the Pavillion. First of all, it was to be a facade, and then it grew and grew and grew. And each member just took a part of this. And so whoever decided they could make domes made domes, and who decided they could make little fences, they made fences. We were so proud because our whole table, which included lots of other things to do with Brighton, including new bathers and goodness knows what, we won the silver prize. So it was worthwhile all our work.
It's such a curious building. It actually defies gender. It's neither male or female. It's a bit of both. I like Brighton.
There was no other centrepiece that one could have but the Royal Pavilion. Brighton is the Royal Pavilion. And, well, the Royal Pavilion's Brighton.
To which he was so kind. I've often seen her bear in front, but you know, I've never seen her bear. Now, come on in.
All the nice girls love a candle. All the nice girls love a wick. All the nice girls love a candle, 'cause it feels just like firm and greasy, slips and easy. It's a nice girl's pride and joy when you walk along the front with a candle up ship ahoy, a sailor boy.
Every town has a reason for its existence. There are towns built on tin, on tobacco, on wine, on wool, on cotton, on beer, on hosiery, on steel, on railways, on slavery. These are all worthily industrious urban types. And then there are the towns which were built on water and quackery. Towns which exploited their mineral springs and became known generically first as wells and then as spas. The eponymous town of Spa is in the Ardennes. A foreign name always lends a certain something. The etiquette of respectability stuck to spas. Indeed, they are to this day considered, wrongly, to be dowdy bastions of terminal Englishness. And the earliest coastal resorts like Brighton, which followed the example of spas, exploited the supposedly beneficial properties of immersion in seawater. The diseases which might be cured by such immersion included gout, dropsy, enders, brast, Quatermain's terms, Badil, the Turkish disease, the Ligurian pock, the French disease, clunch, the stimps, Jacob's Gant. And then there was a further load of diseases which might be cured by actually drinking seawater mixed with milk. Initially, seaside resorts shared with spas a reputation for respectability. The first to receive regular royal patronage was Weymouth. It was made fashionable by Ralph Allen, one of the promoters of Bath, and by the Duke of Gloucester, who was followed there by his brother, King George III, by Queen Charlotte, by their whole family, including their eldest son, the Prince of Wales, who would grow up to become successively the Prince Regent and then King George IV, the most ridiculed and reviled of monarchs in a field where there is traditionally plenty of competition. The Prince of Wales enjoyed the seaside, but, like any young man, reckoned he might enjoy it more away from his parents. So in the 1780s, he began to frequent Brighton, already a resort, but hardly a fashionable one. That would soon change. This town's reputation, and it's a reputation that Brighton has zealously fostered, is that of a South Coast Sodom, a moral sump dressed in stucco. But how could it be otherwise? This town's very reason for existence was, from the start, the pursuit of pleasure. A prince's pursuit of pleasure. Unmitigated by responsibility, unrestrained by parental control, uninhibited by conscience, untrammelled by the prospect of the consequences.
Brighton is, it's a very fascinating place because it's very easy living here to feel as though you're walking up and down in 1815. The past is actually very vivid here in a curious way. By the period at which George IV is coming here regularly, it's the most fashionable spot in England, effectively. George's world is one of hedonism, if you like. He's the eldest son of the king. He's the richest and grandest young man in England. He loves, in the initial stages, dressing up in silk clothes and embroidery. And then he falls in with this extraordinary figure, Beau Brummell, who effectively invents modern dandyism as we understand it, who says to George, this is not the way to dress, this is not the way to do it. You're getting it completely wrong. Beau Brummell gets him into immaculately cut coats. He gets him into very tight breeches, which perhaps is not the best look for a man of George's bulk. There's a salutary example of the dandy's idea of mind over matter. It's to be seen in the museum here in Brighton, where George IV's breeches are on show in a glass case, in a rather large glass case.
He dressed on every which side but loose.
The breeches have a waistline of 54 inches. I mean, it's like looking into a barrel. And this is a pair of breeches made for George in his latter years, by which time he was extremely voluminous. The 54 inches is his waistline when controlled by tight stays. The uncontrolled, heaven knows what shape he was in his latter years.
Thank you.
And yet, in his mind, he remained a svelte Brummellian dandy.
George's unpopularity was both reflected in and caused by contemporary writers and caricaturists.
Fascinating.
Who felt they had an obligation to mock, to deride, to refuse to take George at his own distended estimate. Such satirical art is bereft of sympathy, of empathy, of mercy. It's forged in contempt, shot through with hatred. It's a lesson. But it's a lesson taught by the ultimately impotent. The satirist is a mere flea biting the skin of an elephant.
The prince was a tiny touch elephantine, and many of the depreciations of him were disgracefully stoutist. Others were clothesist, prodigalist, adulterist, gluttonist, vainist.
He deserved the lot, no doubt, but without him it's improbable that the English seaside would have developed in the way that it did. It would much more likely have followed the European model. It might even have held on to the idea of respectability.
In which case the words vulgar, coarse, trashy and cheap would never have become the epithets automatically attached to English seaside resorts.
Come over, son.
And when we get to the top of the pile of such resorts, or should that be the bottom, we can add some more.
Power, my son!
Raffish, meretricious, sleazy, fast, degenerate, immoral, loose, yeah. Libertine, licentious.
Yes, yes! He's done it, my boy's done it.